Good day, everybody. This is Susan Elliott, a host of Mean Lady Talking, and I know that we missed a week of podcasting, and that was due to technical issues in my wiring, in my router, in my something. It has taken Verizon a long time to figure this out. I still don't know if they have. I just know that my ability to upload things have been degrading slowly over the past 4 weeks, and last week it was the podcast that I wasn't able to upload, and one I even lost. So I apologize for the absence, but we're back on the air, and here we go.
Welcome to the Mean Lady Talking Podcast. This is the podcast that tackles tough questions about relationships, life, love, and loss. It may not be the advice you want, but is probably the advice you need. And now here's your host, grief therapist, motivational speaker, relationship expert, best-selling author, and attorney, the not really mean lady herself, Susan J. Elliott.
Okay, we now have reader mail. It's episode 14, and we are going to answer emails that I just got this month, which is exciting. I do have old reader emails that I can read, but I really prefer to read something that is current, something that comes from somebody who's on the Facebook group right now, somebody who's listening to the podcast right now. If you have a situation that you want to email me about, send it to meanladytalkingpodcast@gmail.com. If you have a general question, like a one-line question, just send that to meanladytalkingpodcast@gmail.com. So I've gotten a couple of those in the last few weeks, which is kind of odd because normally my mailbox is inundated with all this mail where people want specific individual attention. And now that I'm asking, like, send me your stuff, they don't want it on the podcast or they're not sending it. So I'm not sure what's going on. I charge over $100 an hour for my counseling fees and more than that for lawyer fees. So if you want free legal information, again, it's not legal advice, it's legal information. There's no attorney-client privilege here. Or you want 25 years of experience as a therapist doing relationship work, send me your issue and just say, you have my permission to talk about this on the podcast. Okay, so here we go. My boyfriend broke up with me 2 months ago after being together for 2 years. We have traveled the world together, working online, but always returned to Bali where we've met. I don't want to get into how he, narcissist 10 years younger than me, treated me, but I have lost myself and went from a strong, funny, confident woman to a depressed, scared, and useless blob. I will soon return to Bali where he still lives. He started going out again and is acting all charming and nice in our bar. It makes me so incredibly angry that he is now back at it and all sweet to everyone while he treated me like a total banana head and I'm still hurting and trying to survive. It feels like an injustice. How do I get over this feeling that the world should know that he is a total dick and treat him accordingly? I know it doesn't matter. I know I should move on and let him do his thing, but I feel as if I'm losing control here and he is rewarded. And another question, how do I accept that I let him treat me so badly? I hate myself almost more than I hate him. That he is a banana head is one thing, but that I have put up with stuff and let it affect me so much is something I cannot forgive myself for. I should have known better than this. Thank you for your answers. This letter is not uncommon. Okay, so here's the thing, and I've said this in videos, I've said it in articles, and now I'm going to say it in a podcast. When we focus on the other person and we don't focus on ourselves, that's two people thinking of the other person and nobody thinking about us. If you've been hurt by somebody who's just gone tra-la-la-ing along and acting as if doesn't bother them, they didn't do anything wrong, and they're just going to fold back into their old life with their old friends and have fun again, that doesn't mean that they're not hurting. It doesn't mean that they're not affected by the breakup, and it doesn't mean that everybody is included into who and what they are. Now, I've told this story before, and I'll tell it again. Both my late husband, Michael, who was the love of my life, I adored the man, and my first husband, who I loathed with a passion, have both passed on in the past few years. Now, Michael was a good man. He was a sweet man. He was a wonderful man. He was a private man. When we had our weekends together, it would be Michael and I and our daughter, and we would watch TV, and we would go out. When we lived in California, we'd go for motorcycle rides through the hills, and we had a really nice life. And the night that I met Michael, and I've said this over and over again when I've talked about him, I said to him, "What do you want out of life?" And he looked at me and said, "I just want to be happy." And he had the most sincere eyes I've ever seen. He told me later on that he fell in love with me the night that we met. And I think that at that moment when he said that, I couldn't believe that that was his goal in life. And it was his goal in life. I mean, he walked that talk. He did just want to be happy. And the things that made him happy, like fishing and NASCAR, had absolutely no meaning to me. And the things that made me happy, like writing and reading and being on the computer, meant nothing to him. He liked our family to be just by ourselves. When we went to a public gathering, when I took him to a social event, he was so uncomfortable. He had ADHD. He had real trouble socializing with people. And he would sometimes pace, like out of the way of everybody else, you know, just waiting for whatever it was to be over because he was so uncomfortable. In fact, the night that I met him, he was standing there by himself. His friends who had brought him were in another room. And he and I got to talking, and we had beautiful one-on-one conversations. But he was not the person who would light up the room when he walked in. Now, my first husband, he was that. He was the center of attention. I had a friend who said to me, "He's larger than life." And he was larger than life because he would walk into a room, into a party, into a social event. He did this at my mother's wake. I mean, we were divorced at the time, and he came to pay his respects to my mother. And then he started telling stories about her because, you know, I think we were like 35 when she passed, and he had known her for 20 years at that point. And he practically lived in my house as a teenager. So he really knew her, and they worked on house projects together and things like that. So he walked into her wake, and without a word of a lie, he started entertaining the entire place with tales of my mother. And they were all very funny. When I went to any party with him, he was the center of attention. He told joke after joke. He had incredible timing, incredible timing. I heard the same jokes from him for 20 years, and still I would manage to laugh because his timing was impeccable. And people that knew him would say, "Tell them the one about blah." You know, they all knew his jokes and they wanted to hear it. His joke telling was amazing. And I would sit there at parties, being alone basically because he was entertaining the entire room and everyone loved him. And we would go home. And then he would start telling me what I was thinking, what I was doing. He would start bitching about the house. He would all of a sudden fly into a rage about something. And I remember coming home from a party with his friends where I basically didn't say two words the entire evening because he was in the center of the room regaling everybody with these jokes. And I didn't know anybody. These were his friends. And he was just commanding the room. And then we got home, it was all about what I did wrong. And I hadn't done anything wrong. I was sitting there like a lump on a log, like I always did. When he passed away, my ex-mother-in-law told me that the lines were around the block to pay their respects. He worked in his union, and he was this social person who had a great stage presence, you know, in any party that he was in. Michael didn't have that. Michael wanted to be alone on the weekends, alone with me and our daughter and the boys when they came and his other daughter, my stepdaughter. That's what he enjoyed. When he got sick, we had a double family room that was off the kitchen. It had French doors. His pool table was on one side. And I put his hospital bed on the other side because I never wanted to lock him away in a bedroom. He just liked being around the family. And the kids would run by and they'd go, "Hi, Grandpa," and he would wave at them. He was a sweet, darling man. And when he passed, there was no lines. There just wasn't. I invited only the family. And then some of my daughter's friends showed up. But it was only supposed to be the family. And I knew that's all Michael wanted. I mean, a lot of people showed up to support me and my kids, but there were not lines around the block. It doesn't matter what the outsides look like. They can fool the world. Narcissists can fool the world. They can convince them that they are the most wonderful people in the world. And the thing is, that's their thing. That's what they do. You can't fall in love with a narcissist and not know that's what they do. But that's not the person you want to be with, because at the end of the day, he's going home like nothing happened. He's going home with no emotions, or he's going home, you know, to start a fight with you or blame everything on you or gaslight you. The person changes. It's Jekyll and Hyde. They get into the room with you alone, and now you're the crazy one. And he uses his charm and his popularity to convince you that you're the problem. Look, everyone loves me. I mean, I had friends who had never really known my first husband who were like shocked over his comedy routine at my mother's wake. They were like, "Who is he? What is he doing? He like hijacked the whole thing." I said, "That's what he does. He comes in, he commands the room. It doesn't matter if it's a wake or a party or a barbecue or whatever." I said, "That's what he does. And everybody thinks he's wonderful." You can't stop people from thinking he's wonderful. You can't stop the narcissist from finding his next victim, because she's out there somewhere, very close by, and she's going to hang on to him because he's the guy. Now, the woman who my first husband married, she worked with him, and she knew what he was, and she kept tabs on him all the time. He was embarrassed when I served him personally at work with a restraining order, because that was not his public image. Narcissists insist that the world love them. That's what they're about. When you get to know them and you see the cracks in the persona and you know that he's really a bastard, you no longer have value. You are pushed to the side because you're not reflecting back to him that he's a great guy. And that's what happens with narcissists. They move on, or they move back, or they do whatever. And it is not about you anymore. It's about who is going to show me love, affection, and attention. Your value has decreased. Your value is gone. I remember telling him early on, I was pregnant with my second or third kid, and I know that I said to him, "You treat me like worn out shoes." And this was years before I divorced him, years before I divorced him. And I knew better. I knew what was going on. I didn't know how to leave. And I think that that's the part that you're stuck on. You didn't know how to leave. First of all, I want you to stop saying "our bar." It's not your bar and his bar. If he's living back there and you're just going there, it's his bar. Let him have it. The woman who married my first husband after me, her granddaughter has gone on my YouTube videos and said, "Your book is a lie." My book is not a lie. And I had many, many more abuse episodes to talk about than I did in my book. The reason why it was chopped down to what it was because I had testified in court. I testified in court. He was there in court. He had every chance to defend. So I'm telling you as a lawyer how it worked. He sought to intimidate me when he subpoenaed witnesses. My mother picked her up for court. I noticed he didn't mention that when he was regaling people at her wake. He didn't mention that. Oh, yeah, so I subpoenaed her, and I asked her to testify against her daughter that her daughter's not a good mother. My mother was shaking in her boots, and I have told the story on another podcast. But the thing is, he tried to intimidate me. He tried to get me to back down. He tried to get me to not testify. I had already done the dirty deed. I had already outed him with a restraining order. And now he was going to fight me because his image was tarnished. And many times as I became a lawyer and watched courtroom dramas play out and family dramas play out in the legal system, I knew exactly what he was doing back then. And it was to get me to back down. It works a lot of time. And it works a lot of times because they have the court of public opinion in their corner. Nobody that he worked with thought that I was worth anything or that I had told the truth about him. My mother got him that job. It was a state job. My whole family had worked there for years and years and years. They got him the job there. And within 2 or 3 years, he was having an affair with one woman there. He had already had an affair before he worked there. And one of the reasons my mother got him the job there was because he had been screwing around with the women on his first job. So she got him this job figuring she's there, my whole family's there, he's not going to play around. He had two affairs there, and I was still married. Two affairs. His second wife had to know about the first affair. And she kept her eye on him. And his goal, when he went to work in that state job, he went to work as a nurse's aide. And his goal was to spend a few years, which is everybody in my family did this. Every single person in my family who worked there at that hospital did this. They started out as a nurse's aide. And when they had some seniority, they transferred to what it was they really wanted to do. I had cousins who went on to be managers in the administration of the hospital. My aunt started out as a nurse's aide. I think within 2 years, she was a medical secretary. She had a lot of secretarial experience. I had another cousin who started out as a nurse's aide, and she also went into the office. And they were good jobs, good paying state jobs with benefits, lots and lots. My mother got him that job. And he had a big life insurance policy. And my kids didn't see any of that. My mother got him the job. On the job, he got an incredible life insurance policy worth a lot of money. And when he passed, my kids didn't see any of it. So that person, to me, is morally corrupt. And his second wife, to not even include my kids, they barely supported them when he was alive. Barely. And to not give them anything when he passed was just horrific. Just horrific. And then her granddaughter goes on my videos and says, your book is a lie. No, sweetheart. I stood in court. Let me explain this to you as a lawyer. I stood in court and I testified. He was in court. He had the opportunity of a defense. Even if he didn't come to court, me serving him gave him an opportunity for defense. He was going to try to intimidate me to not testify. But once I started testifying, he knew his goose was cooked. His lawyer stood up and said, we're not opposing the restraining order. Oh, really? Because you've spent the last few weeks intimidating me with all your opposition and your subpoenas. Really? I believe that his lawyer saw that the judge believed me. So that's on public record, and that is fact. The reason why my ex-husband could not sue me for defamation when he was alive was that fact. I was in court. I testified that you were an abuser. I testified to a lot of abuse episodes. You were there. You heard me, and your lawyer stood up and pulled the opposition. It was over. Slam dunk. Goodbye. That makes my book not a lie. And that's why he didn't sue me. And that's why my publisher and I worked it out so that he couldn't and wouldn't sue me. I couldn't remember all the episodes that I had testified to. So I just did a blanket abuse statement. But the fact that I testified and the fact that he folded, that didn't go back to the people that he worked with. That didn't change people's opinion of him. They figured I must have done something first. That was what they said. I don't care. What they think of me is none of my business. What somebody thinks of you is none of your business. The narcissist will always, always hold the court of public opinion. Always. That's what they do. I had a woman who sat on my couch in my office for weeks. She came to see me as a therapist. She sat there and cried. I didn't even know what the problem was. She just sat there and cried for a few weeks until she started talking. The guy that she was with was a politician in one of the river towns. The river towns in New York along the Hudson are in Westchester, and I think it's Putnam County, which is above Westchester. And I believe that she was in one of the lower river towns, and I don't know if it was Dobbs Ferry or whatever, but it was one of the lower river towns. She sat on my couch and cried for weeks. When she told me about this relationship, it was painful for me to hear. And he was this popular, wonderful politician. And she knew he was so abusive. He gaslighted her. He was horrible. Absolutely horrible. The dressing downs he would give her was sociopathic. It was more than narcissistic. It was sociopathic. Spun her head until it was pudding. That's what narcissists do. That's what they're made of. That's how they operate. When you fall in love with a narcissist, you fall in love with somebody who wants the adoration, who wants the attention, and has nothing to give. The problem comes when we want the world to know what we know. And like you, I felt like when I figured it all out, I was like, wait a minute, why wasn't I smarter than this? This is part one of this answer, and I will go to part two in podcast number 16. But for now, I want to let you know that recovery from being in an abusive relationship with a narcissist is very difficult. It's difficult on several levels, and you've pointed them out very succinctly in your email. Okay, so that is a little bit of how narcissists affect us. For the woman who came and cried on my couch, when she finally was able to speak to me, she was a small, fragile thing. And this crazy, gaslighting, narcissistic, sociopathic lunatic turned her into what you're describing. And it's so unfair, and it's so reckless, and it's so hurtful, and it's so harmful. And what you need to do, whenever you've been involved with a narcissist, a sociopath, whatever it is, an abuser, you know, I never named my first husband as a narcissist. He had narcissistic tendencies, as I'm telling you, with his life of the party thing and the lines around the block. And my friend said, you know, he's larger than life. Yes, he is. But he's also a big dumbass who cheats on me and hits me. And I left when he started moving the abuse toward the kids and the dog. That was it. I was done. You cannot abuse innocent animals or people, especially my children, in front of me. I took it for years, and I'm just not taking it anymore. Sometimes there has to be a catastrophic break. And for me, the night that he was trying to get the kids to march downstairs, which I was not permitting, and he went after the dog went after him. There was this big scuffle. I was afraid he was going to kill my dog. Anyway, when you've been involved with these people, these damaged, disordered lunatics, it scars you. It turns you into something you don't know. I was a raging feminist when I was in a marriage where my husband was cheating on me and beating me. And I'm out there, you know, doing the feminist protest. I'm selling Christmas trees for a woman's shelter. You're living a double life. You're so disconnected from yourself. I talk about splitting and getting past your breakup, but you split the narcissist into good and bad, but you also split yourself into smart and stupid. And I would be out there chanting and yelling and being on the domestic violence hotline and going to classes for how to counsel battered women. Well, I was getting smacked in the face. It makes no sense. Your life makes no sense. What you're doing makes no sense. It's survival. It's, I don't know what to do. That's what it is. You can't harm yourself further by beating up on yourself for being with a thing that you didn't understand, for being taken in by a person that most people will be taken in by. I think his second wife would have moved mountains. He came back to me. He told her, I'm trying a reconciliation. And when I was the one who went, the hell with this reconciliation, he went flying back to her. She had no problem. Sure, take you in. But she kept her foot on his neck for the entire time. He had to check in with her every 2 minutes because she knew what he was. She knew what he was. They each cheated on their spouses with each other. I saw her ex-husband in an AA meeting one night, and he said to me, I didn't know that they were living together. But he recognized me from one of the parties where he had been drunk, and my ex was the center of the room, and his wife was there, and he called her the C word and threw a coat at her and said it was time to go. And I, you know, being magnanimous, said, oh, why don't you come home with us? Tell me if I didn't feel totally stupid when I figured this mess out. So I go to this meeting, and I'm going there with a mentor of mine from Al-Anon. It's a big Saturday night meeting. It was one of these giant AA meetings. And no, it was one of these giant combined AA, Al-Anon, ACOA meetings, which is rare, but it was this big sort of Saturday night recovery jamboree or something. So I'm getting coffee, which is what you do. And I'm standing there getting my coffee, and this man taps me on the shoulder. I turn around. It's my first husband's second wife's first husband. And he says, hi. I said, hi. And I didn't want to know anything. He goes, so your ex and my ex are living together. I did not know that. I was crushed. I did not know that. He didn't tell me that. And even though I didn't want him, and it had been months since I rejected him in the reconciliation effort, I was crushed. Absolutely crushed. And I went to my mentor. And if you heard the first episode of this podcast, this is the person who said to me, if you're looking for sympathy, you'll find it in the dictionary between shit and syphilis. That's in the first episode. So this is the same person. And he was rounding up speakers for the night. And it was going to be like a 2-hour meeting, some long thing. It might have been a group anniversary. I really don't remember. But he pulls me to the side, and I am ready to drop. Ready to just go out in the parking lot and start screaming at the top of my lungs. And I cannot figure out this emotional response because I don't want him. I don't want him. I don't need him. You know, he's too fat for me. You know, that kind of thing. It was like, I didn't want him. I didn't need him. But we were separated probably about a year and a half at this time. I don't remember the exact time frame, but we had long since put the reconciliation thing aside, and I don't know if we were in divorce proceedings or not, but anyway, so this guy, he bounces up, he's so happy that they found each other, because now she's going to leave him the hell alone, and he's a drunk, and he doesn't care, and he's in and out of AA, and he's drinking, and he doesn't care. I'm in the corner, folding like an accordion. And my mentor's circling around the room, circling around. I see him. He's walking, 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 walking. So he turns to me and says, I want you to be the first speaker of the meeting. I went, excuse me, what? I said, did you see I'm having a cardiac arrest over here? I really, you know, I need an ambulance. I don't need to be speaking to people. He goes, get up there and speak. And I said to him, And I remember this night like it happened yesterday. I just don't remember when it was. But I said to him, what am I going to talk about? I gave him, this is a guy who he laughed when I told him that my ex and his new wife bought matching bowling balls. And I was crushed by that. He told me that I could find sympathy between shit and syphilis when I found the love letter from her to him. So he looks at me. So this is the same guy, right? No compassion. No, he had compassion. No sympathy is going on here. I'm folding and he's waving me onto the speaker podium. And I turned to him and I said, my mind is blank. I have no idea what to talk about. No idea at all. And he turned to me and he said, talk about gratitude. I went, gratitude? What? What? I was like, no. He said, I'm telling you, go up there and talk about gratitude. If you've ever seen a person who's kind of shoved on stage, they don't really want to be there. They're like a deer in the headlights. I mean, I've always been a good public speaker and I've spoken in places for hundreds of people and I'm very comfortable up in front of a mic, in front of people, in front of this big hall that we were at and all these people that I knew. I knew a lot of people there. A lot of people that I typically hung out with were there. So I get up there and I'm trashed. I mean, I'm absolutely trashed emotionally. And I get up there and I start speaking. And he's mouthing from the front row, gratitude. Gratitude. Like he kept saying it. And I'm like, oh, shut up. So it was a command. And I knew that I was going to get all kinds of crap if I didn't do this. So I started talking about gratitude. I started talking about my life. I started talking about my children. I started talking about my dog. I started talking about my job. I started talking about my friends. I started talking about all these things that mattered. And I felt gratitude. And the bullshit news that her ex gave me in the beginning of the meeting just faded away. I didn't care. You can have each other. You're both losers. You're both stupid. I don't care. And I felt that, like in my heart of hearts, I felt that. Knock your stupid selves out. Just knock yourself out. She was so stupid. I read her letter to him and it was like a 12-year-old had written it. It was horrible. And I had gotten all worked up over that. And as I was talking about gratitude, I realized that I had no reason to get worked up about absolutely anything. I'm going to make the next two podcasts about narcissists. I'm going to answer your question about forgiving yourself in the next two podcasts. But for now, I want to tell you that you need to remove the victim. And when I say remove the victim, I mean you need to remove yourself from the condemnation that you are giving yourself. You don't need it. You were hoodwinked by a narcissist. Many very smart people are. The trick comes in your healing. The trick comes in not being fooled again. That's the part that you need to worry about, not being fooled again. But you can't get there if you are just pounding away at yourself on how smart you should have been, or how smart you are and how stupid you acted. You didn't know that you didn't know. And you have to bring yourself back into your own heart and say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for pushing you out when you needed me. You cannot heal if you continue to judge yourself as lacking, as wanting, as bad and stupid and a blob. You cannot heal yourself with that attitude. You have to take the victim away from you and away from the narcissist. It doesn't matter what he does. It doesn't matter what he says. It doesn't matter how many people like him. You said that in your email. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. The world is going to line the block at his wake. But that has absolutely zero value to show the kind of person he really was. It means nothing. My husband, Michael, was one of the sweetest, kindest men in the world. When he said to me the night we met, I just want to be happy. He lived that. He didn't want crap. He didn't want useless arguments. He didn't want anything. He just wanted to be happy. He wanted to fish. He wanted to watch his races on Sunday. He wanted to mourn, you know, the time between, like, I think it's like October and January when there's no racing on and no fishing, except in California, he was able to go motorcycle riding. But there was not a lot of people who came to Michael's wake and his memorial. But he was such a gentle, sweet, loving man who put his priorities in order. And his priorities were his wife and his kids. And that was it. He wanted to be with someone who wouldn't stand in the way of the things he wanted to do to be happy. And he didn't want to be called names. He told me that the very first night. Because I asked him why he divorced his wife, the mother of his daughter. And he said, because she called me names in front of the kids, screamed at me in front of the kids. And one night he told her, he said, you're not doing this to me anymore. And the next time she did it, he walked out the door. He just wanted to be happy. He walked that talk. And I was incredibly, incredibly impressed. He didn't sweat the small stuff. There was no useless arguments with him. He didn't play the blame game. He didn't need somebody to blame when a chair was left out on the dining room. And I remember that. It's like, that's what I remember, was when we had all five kids in the house and we would come out of what we had, a master suite. It was our office, the library, and our bedroom and our bathroom. And it was shut off from the rest of the house. But my daughter was, you know, 3, 4, 5 when we lived there. So she was in that part with us as well. But the other kids were teenagers and they were out and whatever. So every time we came out of the room, we came out to the dining room, and the one chair from the dining room table would be pushed over so that when we opened our door, it hit it. And Michael would take it and he would shove it in and he would say, can anybody put this chair back? And he would just sort of shout it to the room. And I mean, that just went on all the time. And I said to the kids one day, would you just please, he doesn't ask for much, just please push that freaking chair in. But he never sat them down and said, look, you know, you're gonna be punished if you keep doing this with the chair. And there was one time, and Michael had his priorities absolutely straight. He didn't interfere. My middle son, Michael, was in trouble in school, suspended, or, you know, all kinds of things. And I finally got fed up. I got fed up with going to school. I got fed up with the teachers. I mean, I defended him when he was right, and I punished him when he was wrong. But there was one point, I think he was 16 or 17, I got completely fed up. And I said, don't go to school. I don't care. A parent had to go to school to get him back in. And I was done. I'm like, I'm done. I'm not doing this, Michael. You go find an apartment, find a job. You're 16. Do whatever the hell you want. I don't care. I give up. I was angry. I was really angry. And my husband, Michael, put on his shoes and said, Michael, get in the truck. And off they went. He got him back into school. But that was Michael. I mean, it was like he never said something unless it was a real issue. And he would always say to my son, Michael, that's your mother. You speak to her. Because we would get into shouting matches and then we'd stop speaking to each other. And he would say, Michael, I don't care who's right or wrong. That's your mother. Speak to her. And I knew that Michael and I were going to have issues when he passed. And Michael, my son, came to help me when Michael was sick. It's hard when you're talking about the Michaels, because that's how we called them, the Michaels. And after he passed, my son Michael told me that one time he was really mouthy or something. I don't remember what it was. But he said something. I think he said something about me. And Michael, my husband, who was actually smaller than Michael, because my son Michael's like 5'10", and my husband Michael's like 5'6", but he was brawny and built. And my son Michael said that one time he was mouthing off to me or something, and Michael, my husband, grabbed him by the shirt. And Michael said that, like, he put the fear of God into him. And I knew nothing about this, because I never had really introduced my kids to men. There was one man that I lived with for 5 years before my husband, Michael. And there were other guys that I dated. And they might have had like a dinner or a lunch or something with one or two other guys, but for the most part, I didn't introduce my kids to people that I dated unless it was long-term relationship. And of course, Michael and I were married, so it was a long-term relationship. But I always told them, I always told the guys, these are my kids, like I will handle that. But Michael handled Michael, you know, it was just the way that it was. And he chose his battles. And I can tell you that over the course of our relationship, I could count our serious arguments on one hand. And it was usually early on because we had different styles of arguing. And Michael didn't like me to be mad at him. So he kind of followed me around and I would say, stop following me. Stop doing this. But that was a learning thing that we had to go through. But what I'm trying to say is there was not a line at Michael's wake. There were people there who adored him because he was a wonderful, sweet, happy man who just wanted to be happy. I couldn't imagine Michael hitting a woman if you gave me $1 million and said, I want you to picture Michael hitting a woman. And if you can conjure up that image in your head and describe it for us, we'll give you $1 million. I couldn't, for all the money in the world, I could not. But he was private and he was quiet. And all he wanted on the weekends was to hang out with his wife and his daughter and the rest of the kids. And went out to dinner all the time. Michael was a simple guy. He wasn't a narcissist. He didn't give a shit what the world thought of him. He really didn't. He had absolutely not a care in the world. When you fall for a narcissist, the only way to get to a guy like that is to forgive yourself, to learn about the narcissist, which I'm going to go into more in the next two. And then I still have the co-parenting thing to go through. I still have more parts to that. But you cannot heal from narcissistic abuse, from narcissistic gaslighting, from narcissistic bullshit until you forgive yourself for not knowing what you didn't know. That's an important piece of the puzzle. You have to forgive yourself. Remove the victim. You and the narcissist are no longer together. The narcissist is living in your head and renting space he does not pay for. And you're beating the crap out of you. And you deserve much more than that. So for now, I want you to forgive yourself. I want you to do self-care. I want you to not think of our bar. It's now his bar. Let him have it. Anybody who wants him, take him. You're done. Remove the victim. Remove the victim from him. Remove the victim from mutual friends. But most important, remove the victim from your judgment. You don't deserve it, and it's not okay. Take care of you. Start that immediately. You can do this. You absolutely can do this. And I want you to do this. Take care of you. Talk to you soon. Take care, everybody. Keep those emails coming.